guess which I'm like this one, so.
Okay, so we'll so now this course you see, so it is essentially about CE6320 as already mentioned you. Oh God. Now you are able to see, right? So
yes,
you are able
sir.
To see that. Okay, fine. So this course, you know, so 6320. So it is around engineering seismology, you know. And hazard assessment. Okay, so now this course is a, you would have seen online, you know, the syllabus and other things are there. So this course was floated long back. Okay, the syllabus has not been changed and all other, you know, so many things are there. So now coming to this syllabus, you know, what we are going to cover in this course and other things. So we have basically, you know, three things we will do. One is, you know, the seismic hazard. So this is the most important component, okay, seismic hazard analysis. So here we will be discussing, you know, deterministic. First we will start with data, okay, the introduction to, you know, this data analysis, the strong motion data analysis we say. So some regression equations, you know, so ground motion prediction equations we say, okay. So these type of ground motion prediction equations we will discuss. Then finally, you see, we will also discuss probabilistic and you know, and deterministic seismic hazard analysis. Hazard analysis. So this is one component in our course. Now another one we also will discuss, you know, the geodynamics also little bit. Okay. So here we will be discussing about, you see, the plate modeling, a tectonic plate modeling, okay, the plate tectonics, you know, the mechanics. So you people would have done this mechanics of materials or advanced structural mechanics course, okay, in your undergraduate, I think mechanics of materials, and maybe in postgraduates, advanced structural mechanics you would have done last semester. So we will use this, whatever you have studied there, say, in strength of material formulas and other things, that bending formula, buckling formula, and all those things. So we will apply for plate tectonics also, okay, for modeling the Indian plate, you know, so several tectonic plates, say, how, you know, these things happen, what is the buckling strength, bending, all those deflections and all those things we will be covering. So this is one unit, and we also will discuss, you know, this wave propagation. Okay, so we will discuss, you know, how to simulate this ground motion, say, simulation, you see, for earthquakes. Okay, so synthetic ground motions essentially. So from theory, that is you know, theoretical, so we will discuss all those things, okay. So theoretical you know, approaches are there, then you know, the seismological approaches we say. So all those things, you know, we will cover in this unit itself, okay. So if time permits, maybe, you know, we will also discuss this some computational tools also. Okay, so like FEM, you know, some of those techniques, finite element and finite difference methods, to how to simulate this ground motions here itself, okay. So total some 4 units are there. So now when we discuss about seismic hazard, we also will discuss, you know, the introduction also, like what do you mean by earthquake and other things you would have known, but this also we'll discuss it in great detail, okay. So something like 4 units or 5 units, you know, we'll be having for this course. And now regarding the, and I just wanted to mention you, See, this course is not like other courses. See, the you would have done like BTech, MTech, say the core courses. See, core courses generally, you know, that is all syllabus will be fixed and, you know, everything will be fixed. But this is more, you know, elective course, and this is a research elective. Okay, so this is basically a research course. So mostly, you know, we will be discussing about, you know, the research, that is, you know, the challenges or, you know, something new. Things, you know, in engineering seismology and all those things itself. And here the more, you know, the emphasis will be on, will be given on learning, okay, rather than grading and other, you know, the kind of issues itself. And now coming to our references, the textbooks and other things. So we will be following wide variety of textbooks. And now if you see in markets, you don't have a good book on engineering seismology, okay? So some chapters here, some textbook here and there will be there. So, and of course, some papers also are there. We'll be referring to all those things. So one book will be, you know, this geodynamics. This textbook we will use. So Turcotte and Schubert. So these are the authors, okay? So this book we will use, you know, to discuss about plate modeling, some simple mechanics of materials and other things we will see. Then other books when it comes to wave propagation. Okay, so we will see this wave propagation in elastic solids. So there is a, you know, Achenbach book is there, Achenbach. Then there is one more book, same, almost the title is same, that is by Graft. Okay, so these two books also we will follow. Then there are some, you know, the books are there like these, you know, seismic sources, say, waves and sources. Okay, by Ben Menham, you know. So he is an Israeli person, and S.J. Singh, Sarvajit Singh, okay. So this textbook is there. Then, you know, we also will see on seismic hazard analysis. Say. So there is a recent textbook which is going to come up. So that is by Baker. Okay. So Baker, you know, I think one more author, maybe the Stafford or somebody. So these textbooks are all available online. You can download and you can see also. Okay. So apart from that, there are several textbooks are there on theoretical seismology, you know. Okay. So there is Woodias, Augustine Woodias. So many textbooks are there. Then quantitative seismology. So these are all reference books. Okay, by Aki and Richards. So all these books, you know, we will see, and of course some you know, published journal papers. So this also we will add whenever there is required. Okay, so this, so all these things we will be using, you know, for this course itself, and there are many other books also. So whenever time is required, you know, I will you know, tell you about this one. So all the soft copies are also available online. So some TAs will be there. So they will send you also, if we will have to form a WhatsApp group also. So if there is any help required in this textbook, so they will also will help. And our IITM library also has bought some of these books. I think, you know, you can take some of them, you know, online, you know, I think that also is, you know, possible, it seems nowadays. Okay. So this is our textbooks, the syllabus, and then coming to the grading patterns. So as already I told you, this course is a different research kind of a course. Coming to this grading pattern, we will be having one exam. Okay. And then we also will be having a Viva also. So in the end, you know, I will take a Viva, like you see, some 15 to 20 minutes Viva for each one of you, to understand whether you have understood the basic, you know, the fundamentals of the subject itself. Then we also will be having assignments. Okay, so these three will be there. Now how much percentage you will put it on exam, Viva and assignments, that may be later on, you know, we will decide after some point of a time, you know, as per our you know, convenience and discussion and other things. So this is very, very important for this course. And maybe you may have to do some project also, a mini project kind of a thing. So I will send you, you know, some data sets or something you may have to download, and then maybe, you know, you have to do. So all these four things we will be using for grading. So how much percentage, that maybe, you know, we will decide, you know, later. But right now, this is how the grading pattern is going to be. Okay. So this is our overall, you know, the syllabus, then the grading pattern, and then this textbooks. So if any one of you have any questions, you know, you can ask me now. Now, so if any one of you followed it, if you have any doubts or questions, ask me. Yeah, so if we so you don't have any questions, eh? So you are able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you don't have any questions, so then we will
yes,
start
sir.
Our okay, so there is syllabus, I think everything is clear, right?
Yes, sir.
So now when we will start with our fundamental things, okay? Yeah, so now you are able to see the screen, right? The slides.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so now let us start our course. So I will be using that whiteboard as well as, you know, this slides also for this course itself. Yeah. Now the first thing is, you know, why do we require, you know, the earthquakes are important for engineers. Okay, why civil engineers have to study this subject? And why we have to do this thing, you know. See, like this course, you know, no mechanical engineer does, okay? No electrical engineer does. But only the civil engineers only will do, you know, this earthquake engineering or this seismology course. So why earthquakes are so important to civil engineers? So this is a fundamental question, you see. Why you have to study these earthquakes? So now you followed, right? See, generally the mentality is, everybody knows that, you know, earthquakes doesn't kill people, buildings will kill the people itself. Okay, so this is a simple thing, you know, because when earthquake occurs, building starts vibrating, and then, you know, this leads to collapse and people gets you know, killed also. Now the main reason why, you know, the buildings, you know, it is very sensitive is this figure itself. So generally whenever an earthquake occurs is there, okay, so this is how, you know, we record this acceleration time history. So there are instruments are there. After some point of a time, I will also show you. So these three components will be there. So two horizontals, and then it is ground motion is basically a vector. So you have, you know, all the three components will be there. East, west direction, then north, south. Then we have the vertical component also. Okay. So when you record, you know, the acceleration time histories, they look something like this. So this is a vertical component. This is, you know, the north, south component, and this is east, west component. So when you look at these three time histories, say, you will not observe any pattern. They look like, you know, a random kind of a thing. So most of them, you know, they start with zero and they keep on increasing. Okay, they will keep up to some point, and then finally, so after some point of a time, you know, everything comes back to zero itself. Okay, so this is how, you know, you can see these earthquake acceleration time histories. You know, they look like this. So all the components. So if you see east-west component also, it starts with zero. Slowly it starts increasing, say, and then finally, you know, everything comes back to zero itself. So this is how earthquake acceleration time histories looks like. Now this time histories, say, they will not tell you, you know, exactly, you know, what is happening during an earthquake itself, but, you know, if you plot its frequency content, okay, so this is what we call as, you know, the power spectral density plot. Okay, so this power spectral density, if you try to plot, say, we will discuss later also, just by a Fourier transform. Okay, so of this is one. So you will have it, you know, the figure looks like this. So x axis is a frequency, y axis is a power spectral density. So if you plot, say, the, you know, it looks something like this. So you can see earthquakes have energy from, you know, 0 hertz, you know, the frequency has, and the earthquakes energy up to 25 hertz will be the you know, the region where earthquakes, you know, excite this frequencies itself. Now where is most of the energy concentrated on? No. So most of the energy is concentrated on which frequency?
So up to 10 0 to 10.
Zero to 10 only, but where is the maximum value? Around which frequency?
Around 5.
Around this portion, say you have the maximum value located here. So all the earthquakes goes from 0 to 25, but most of the energy will be from 0 to 10. So this is the data for Sikkim earthquake, but some other earthquake, if you plot, say there also you will see this kind of a thing, but maybe the peak may be shifted to 1 hertz or maybe somewhere around this itself. And now this is the most critical thing for civil engineering. Now, if you see all our civil engineering structures, say there is one thumb rule we use. Okay, of course, IS code, there is a much better formula to find out the natural frequency. But this is one thumb rule we use actually. Okay, so where natural frequency is given by 1 by 0.1 times n, or natural time period, say, which is reciprocal, that is 0.1 times n, where n is the number of stories. So if it is a single story building, say, what will be its time period? For single story building,
0.1 seconds.
So its natural frequency will be reciprocal. Okay. So what is the reciprocal of 0.1?
10 hertz.
10 hertz. Suppose if you have a two story building, say, what will be its natural frequency? 2 story building.
5 hertz.
It is 5 hertz. Okay. So now if you are having a 10-story building, say, so 10-story building means, its natural frequency will be, 1 hertz itself. You followed. So 20-story building, say, so 20-story building means, your natural frequency still decreases. So as number of stories increases, natural frequency decreases, or natural time period increases, because they are reciprocal to each other. And then if you take a bridge, so for bridges, so what is the natural frequency for a bridge approximately? See, for a bridge, say some span, some 100 meter span or whatever you have, or maybe followed, right, 50 meter span or whatever. So the bridges are there. Okay, so now what will be their natural frequencies of these bridges? Now, do you have any idea what will be its natural frequency, in which range they have bridges? Say? Approximately 0.1 to
0.5.
So approximately, 0.1 to 1 hertz, the bridge natural frequencies will be there. And if you have power plant structures, say the tall, the transmission line towers and other things also. So most of all our civil engineering structures, the natural frequencies, lies in between, 0.1 to 10 hertz. Now what happens? Earthquake also, the most of the energy is concentrated from 0 to 10 hertz itself. So now what happens when earthquake frequency, when our civil engineering structure frequency, both of them match, say, what happens? What will happen when the exciting resonance. frequencies, resonance occurs. So when resonance occurs, what happens? In your dynamics, you would have studied. So when you are having a single degree of freedom system, say, subjected to resonance, what happens?
The amplitude increases and tends to infinity.
And amplitude increases. How it increases? Any of you remember? So if you have, the amplitude, say, okay. So how it increases, you remember, right? You would have done for a damp, it is, it slowly you followed, right? So like this, you followed, right? It keeps on and it goes up to infinity. It doesn't go to infinity, but slowly, it peaks up to infinity itself, okay? So that is why you see, so civil engineering structures, say, okay? So these earthquakes becomes very important for our civil engineering structures. But mechanical systems, what happens? For piping, what is the natural frequency? For piping, mechanical structures, so turbines, these generators and other things. So mechanical structures, their natural frequency will be somewhere around 20 hertz, more than this range, okay? More than 10 hertz they will be, like 15 hertz, 20 hertz, 25, 33 hertz, like that the mechanical structures will be. So for mechanical equipment, say, earthquakes are important or not important?
It's important.
Important, why?
Because earthquake has a range of 0 to 25 hertz. Even though low frequency also may affect the turbines.
Okay, no. The earthquake has only 0 to 10 hertz only. You followed, right? 0 to 10 only. But more than that, earthquake energy doesn't come. Okay, so now I'm asking you, what you told, it is important only. But what is the reason?
Because
There is no resonance for mechanical structures. Although energy is very, very small, you can see here. Whether it is important, why? What is the reason?
I think in order to get to that frequency, it should pass through the in-between frequencies.
Okay, that is what you feel actually. Okay, but it is a very simple. Okay,
see, so frequency of machines doesn't match with the natural frequency of earthquake, so it is not so important, I think, sir.
It is not so important. Okay, so some of you are saying it is important, some of you are saying it is not at all important. Okay, but it is important only. The reason why is, although you may not have any resonance, but all mechanical structures, they stand on what type of structures?
Sir, I said buildings, sir.
Civil structures only. They will not stand on a building. See, like for example, if you have a generator or water, you have to design foundation, right, for all of them. So if foundation collapses, so what happens?
The transmission of frequency or forces will occur to the machine.
The transmission of forces will be there, but all our mechanical structures, piping systems are there, say. They all will be located on top of these civil structures only. So if civil foundation collapses, then gone case only, you followed, right? So whether it's a mechanical or electrical, whatever is there, you have to design foundation. So foundation itself is a civil structure, so it will have natural frequency from 0.1 to 10 only. So automatically, if that starts vibrating and that collapses, then automatically, this also goes away actually, okay? So this is the reason why mechanical people, they don't study earthquake engineering, but everything comes back to civil people only, because the foundation also has to be designed by a civil engineer itself, okay? So these are the main reasons why civil engineers have to study earthquakes, why mechanical and your electrical friends say they don't take these earthquakes, serious fashion itself. So this you have to understand, okay? Very, very important thing. Now, of course, these are all very, very, very well established. Maybe, you may be hearing, some of you maybe for the first time, but these things was all, established long back itself. But nowadays, there is a lot of craze about earthquakes, nowadays, okay? So let us see why this craze is about, okay? So now, if you see in 1600s, so this has related to, our population break and, the city concept, the urban cities and other things also. In 1600, if you see, if you plot the number of towns all over the world which have population more than 1 million, okay? So you can see very few cities are there in the entire, the world itself. In India, you can see here one small, is there maybe Calcutta or forwarded, that area, say. The population was much, much higher than, 1 million the population used to be there. Then in 1950s, say, okay? So this concept of, super city, mega city, this concept came into picture. A super city, say, the definition is a population is more than 2 million. It is a super city. Mega city means population is more than, 8 million. So then, the number of dots have increased. Now in India itself, if you see, so we have now three. One is Delhi, then Calcutta, Chennai or Bombay, you followed, right? Some three cities have come into picture, but three were super cities. So we started these mega cities also, in Europe and in America and some places also. Now, if you see in 2000, say, now, in India itself, we have, 28 mega cities are there in India. Mega city, the definition is population more than 8 million. And now slowly you followed, right? Many cities have come into picture. This urbanization, maybe population, better jobs or life, this one. So people have started more than, moving towards this cities itself. And now if you see in India, say, how many cities are there which have population more than 1 million? Can any of you know? In India itself, population more than 1 million. How many cities will be there in India right now? In 2021 or something, they will do a census. In 2011, we had a census. So 10 years they do. So Indian, how many cities are there in our country which have population more than 1 million? Just guess and tell me.
Hundred to two hundred,
if the exact number is something around 60, you followed, right? In 2011 we had 48. Now it has increased 10 million. Sorry, the population more than this much. So this is how you can see the population, how it has increased in Chennai, Delhi, Bombay, you followed, right? Exponential growth itself. And you can see in India, so these agglomerations, okay? So how they have increased. In 2011, 2009, some census was there, 48 was there, but now I think 60 or maybe more than, you know, it happened. And now this is also very interesting slide here. So you can see here in this slide also, the total urban population is plotted here, okay, versus here. So this is for the world population, this is for the India here. Yeah. So now in world population, say, okay, so then now 2010 was a very, very special year in the whole world actually. What is the reason? Can anybody point out this portion? Now, what is the speciality of this one, which is linked to 2010? Now, what is the, you see the y-axis also? Now, what is the speciality? Now, what is the speciality?
The population 50% in urban.
What does it mean? Physically, what urban population, that is. So in the whole world, 50% of the population is living in cities rather than in villages. You followed? So like you remember, no? Gandhiji, what Gandhiji told during freedom, that our independence. For India, what is important in India? Gandhiji, what he told?
Agriculture, developing villages.
Villages was the rural population was a very important, like that Gandhiji says. Now, what is the situation? See, where most of the people are living?
So, all are in cities, urban areas.
Cities only. So, now for India, say, villages are not so important, but where is the most important thing is city only. Because a lot of taxpayers, you know, so much of money gets generated in cities itself. So 2010, it was a very, very special for the entire world because, you know, 50% this, but of course in India still, you know, the 30% only are people are living in cities in 2010. But now I think this graph is also maybe wrong, but this is a projected portion. Okay. So now it may would have gone like this also. We have no idea. You followed, right? So maybe 2050 or maybe somewhere around 2040, India, they have predicted that 50% will be in cities rather than in the villages. That's how, you know, it has been projected. Okay. So this is how, you know, the numbers are there. So now for India, say, for any country or for the whole world, the most important thing is city, not a village, because, you know, that is the most economical things are happening around cities itself. So because of city concept, you know, jobs and other things, you know, everybody is migrating towards cities itself. So now what happened? So now you can see I have plotted here many of the important cities, that is more than, you know, population. You can see Jodhpur is here, some 48 cities I have plotted. Hyderabad, you see, Vijayawada, Vishakhapatnam. I think some of you are from Vizag, right? It is a mega city, okay? Bhubaneswar is here, Chennai. You can see in South India also there are many cities are there. Now when you see in here, say Delhi, Meerut, Agra is there, Lucknow, Kanpur, Gwalior, you know, there are many cities are have been 48 cities are there. Now I think you will have extra some more number of things itself. Now here the most important thing is this graph also I am showing you the dots, that is a past earthquakes which have occurred in our India itself. So now you can see. So now what does it tells you? See, suppose for example in Agra, say this portion, if you see what are the earthquakes here, you can see some dots here, red dot is there and black dot is there. So black dot indicates magnitude, you know, 8 magnitude, and this is a 7 to 8 magnitude, 6 to 7, 5 to 6, like that, you know, these dots indicates. Okay. So now what is that more scaring for you? Now, see, Srinagar is here. You followed, right? So now you can see, now if you name any city, say in India, Agra is there, Delhi also you can see where, you know, it is there here. Now what is, and are here in Gujarat also, if you can see a lot of, you know, the earthquakes are there. So what does it tells you when you look at this graph? So now what is, you know, what does this tells me?
So cities are located on the earthquake prone areas in North India compared to South Indian cities.
So what does it means you? So if there is any damaging earthquakes are going, so now generally the feeling is earthquakes will occur at a place where they have occurred in the past also. You followed, right? Like elastic kind of a thing. So now, so if you see these cities, say, so now what is happening? We are building cities, okay? All the economy, money, everything is diverted to a city itself, okay? So now once earthquake happens, then these cities will be in great danger itself. So now let us see. So now you can see the economic losses, okay? So now if you see in 1950 Indian budget, that it was a Republic Day budget, we say. India became a republic here. So now just recently only, right, we celebrated our Indian Republic Day, say. Our Indian budget, say, the first Indian Republic budget, the amount was how much? Can you read here? This was our budget amount, 347 crores. That was in Indian rupees at that time. Now people are talking in terms of dollars, but at that time it was in rupees. And in 1950s, there was one very, very great earthquake in Assam. Okay, you can see here. That is this earthquake, 1950. Can you see the black dot here? So this was an earthquake and its magnitude was 8.6 actually. The largest earthquake which has occurred, known to occur in the Himalayas. The highest magnitude is for this event only. Now when this earthquake occurred, so what was the economic loss? 5 million rupees. 5 million means 1 million is how much?
10 lakhs.
10 lakhs means 50 lakh rupees actual. So the loss was 50 lakhs. Okay. But our budget was how much? 350 crores. So what is the percentage? So 50 by, you see, 350 crores, say. You followed, right? And this was in lakhs. So if you write in terms of percentage, it is less than, some 0.001% or, it was nothing actually, because when you compare it to the Indian budget. So, economy loss was very, very less actually. Now, if you see in 2001, so what was our Indian budget? How much? You can read this one number. How much was Indian budget?
50 billion.
Dollars. Now people started in talking in terms of dollars. Okay. And now what was economic loss for Bhuj earthquake? 5 billion has gone down here. So the economic loss was, you see, $5 billion. Now, what is the percentage?
10%.
Almost, you followed, right? 10% of 50, so 10% of budget is eaten by one earthquake, actually. And then similarly, say, Kashmir earthquake occurred in 2005. Its economic loss is, $5.2 billion. China, there was one earthquake. $75 billion was economic loss. Then 2011 Japan, the economic loss was $324 billion. And this Japan earthquake magnitude was 9.1, the Tohoku earthquake. They say. Now, what is our Indian budget in 2019-20? Now, how much is the amount?
382
billion dollars. Of course, yesterday Sita Raman, she presented, but I have not followed, so I don't know the number, the recent budget. Okay. So now you compare Japan and this one. How much here? What percentage now? Now, how much percentage Japan earthquake, and if you compare Indian budgets, how much?
85%.
Almost 85, you can say 100% itself, you followed, right? And then in Nepal earthquake also, $10 billion was there. And Nepal, they say 50% of Nepal GDP, this earthquake has done. So Nepal has become poorer actually. Poorer country, almost 50% of its wealth got, finished due to this earthquake itself. So now what is that you can see here? What is the pattern you are seeing here? When you compare it to olden days to the recent days. What is that you have observed here?
Earthquakes are becoming more severe and making more damage.
Why more damages?
Since they are occurring in the most populated area or cities, urbanized area.
So cities, urbanization is happening. But if one city loses, means, gone, that's all. And you followed, right? Now the situation has become like one earthquake is sufficient to eat away the full budget itself, actually. So if now today, if earthquake occurs in Delhi, say nearby in Himalaya, Delhi, if Delhi goes down, say, just imagine how much will be the economic loss. You may have to, the parliament building is getting constructed. 1000 crores, you know, 2000 crores, 3000 crores. You see, how many bridges are there? How many heritage buildings are there? How many, you know, tall structures are there? If all of them goes away, say, so one city itself is sufficient actually, okay, for one Indian budget. Now, what happens? One earthquake eats away one budget. Say, what happens? Or let us say, you know, to, 5-6 earthquakes occur in the same year. So then what happens to our country?
The entire GDP will fall, sir.
What happens if entire GDP falls? Now we are seeing, right, COVID situation. What is the economy? All of us have got screwed, no?
Yes, sir.
So the complete economy, you know, of course, COVID is a different situation. But earthquake means, you know, the property collapses. Economy will be gone. Money is one thing. But another thing is how much time it will take to build a city like Delhi, you know, or how much time it takes to build a city like Chennai or Hyderabad. So these cities have not been made in one day. You know, they have been made for so many years. People have invested time and money, and this one, that Bombay, you know, the cities have come up. And one earthquake is sufficient to damage, you know, few seconds itself to the whole the country, this itself. So that's what they say. So the next great earthquakes, the people, you know, many people have predicted, if there is a many big earthquakes, say, so if the damage will be at, you know, $1 trillion. Now almost this billion has gone. Now it will be, you know, in trillions itself. So earthquakes means, you know, not only, you know, the human loss. Human loss is a different thing. But economy is a very, very important thing, you know, right now. Okay. So you all of, you know, this COVID situation and everybody is talking, right? Economy, 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 you followed, right? So this is a very, very important thing for earthquakes. So this is one very important thing which has done, you know, by some people. So they say in Assam, say, okay. So there was one earthquake in 1819. So this was the epicenter of that earthquake. And depth, and this was the magnitude. Okay, so now suppose if this earthquake occurs right now, so these numbers are like this. So 8.1 magnitude earthquake, if it occurs in Assam region, say, so they say that how many people are going to die? What is expected deaths? You can read the units are in thousands. So how many people are going to die?
So maximum 50,000 people.
50,000 people are going to die. How many people will be injured? So this slide is for injured people. Almost, you know, more than 50,000 are, you followed it. That many people will be, you know, injured, they say. Now, some earthquake, if it occurs in Garhwal region, say, in that is in, you know, Uttarakhand region. So you can say the number of, you know, deaths will be 58,000 or maybe, you know, more 1 lakh deaths or something. And here's our things itself. So this is, so now who is interested in these type of, who is interested in deaths, human losses? So there are two things. One is a human loss, other one is economic loss. Who is more worried about human loss? No. Who is more worried about human losses?
Politicians, sir, businessmen, manufacturers.
Politicians doesn't worry, you followed, right? Human loss, which politician worries, right? See, nobody is interested in human loss. Money, economic loss, politicians will be interested. The government will be interested, you followed, right? But who is more worried about human loss? Who will lose when somebody dies? See, somebody dies, say, who is who will, you know, weep so much?
Family, sir.
Family? No, 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 no. Family, that is fine, okay. But who is the fellow who worries about death, say? Which company people are more interested in death?
Insurance.
Insurance people, actually. See, suppose somebody takes insurance policy of 50 lakhs, say, and then he dies next year, who will weep? You followed, right? See, somebody has taken 50 lakhs insurance policy, term policy he has taken, say, and then he will pay 1 year premium and then he collapses, okay? So now who will weep? Insurance fellow. Family, of course, family loss will be there, but family people will get 50 lakhs, right? At least something will be there for them. But the insurance company, you followed, right? Huge losses will be there, human losses. So just imagine if all these 50,000 people, say, in Assam, they all take insurance policy for 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs, actually. And all of them die. Now, how much will be the loss for insurance company? They have to settle how many claims, say? 50,000 people dying, say. So 50,000 multiplied by 10 lakhs. You follow, right? How much will be this amount? So huge amount actually. So the company will be, you know, out actually. You followed. And nowadays, you know, right? Medical insurance also is there, you know, like, you know, COVID also, we have Corona, Kavach, all kinds of insurances are there. So just imagine, you see all these people take insurances, you know, your medical, this one, you followed, right? So the insurance companies, you know, they will be sink actually. So who is more worried about deaths among all the families? That is one thing, that is an emotional issue. But if you talk in terms of losses, say, so who is more worried about deaths is, you know, these insurance companies actually. So generally insurance companies, what do they do? Once you have taken insurance policy from the insurance company, say, what that your agent will do? Yeah. So what insurance agents do? What is their main objective? See what insurance people will do. What they will wish for, you know, once you have taken a policy from their company, say.
Live long.
Live long, actually. That's the best, excellent answer. So they will pray to God that, you know, you will live 100 years, actually. So that, you know, that fellow, your premium itself, you know, they will collect and they will give it back to you, like a survival benefit or something. So these insurance people are our well-wishers for your health, okay? So even when you buy a car and you take insurance, insurance fellow will always will be praying that, you know, your car will not meet any accident, actually. Because if it meets an accident, the loss will be for the insurance company. So this is the most important thing, the insurance company. And now these also same thing. So the insurance companies say they have even worked out all these numbers, because, you know, how much premium you have to pay, they do all these calculations. So they have done, like, you know, if there is earthquake in 1897 Shillong, say, so when the earthquake occurred in 1897, 1500 people died actually. But if the same earthquakes occurs right now, say, so they say that 90,000 people, you followed, right, they will, you know, die right now. So these insurance companies, you know, they will be calculating all these, you know, the human losses, because, you know, they are very more interested in these things itself. Now, if you see, right, most of our, as already I told you, so I showed with epicenters. But if you see most of our Indian cities, say, so you have, these are all cities, actually, these field squares, you can see, right, here, all these Chennai, these are all the cities. Most of the cities in India, say, they are all located on top of the faults. So these red lines you are seeing right here. So these are all, these red lines are all faults here. Okay. This is available. This data set is available. I will provide you also later on. So most of the cities, say, all of them are lying on top of the faults. So Chennai is here. Near Chennai also, we have a Palar River fault is there. Then, you know, you name any city, say, Delhi, if you say, you have a great boundary fault is there, Mahendranagar, Dehradun fault is there, Lucknow fault is there. The name itself, you know, the Lucknow fault, it goes below Lucknow city itself, okay? So like this in here, you know, Calcutta also, we have many places, say, so many faults are there. So now, you know, any of this fault can rupture in future and you can have an earthquake. So if an earthquake occurs, say, economic loss will be there, human loss also will be there actually, okay? So the most important thing here it is, so these also like economic loss, they have computed, not only the human losses. So they say this was done in, I think, 2001, maybe 2002, around that time, because Gujarat earthquake occurred, right? So government, you know, they asked these companies to do these economic losses. So they did this type of study. They say that if there is a 7 magnitude earthquake in Delhi, nah. So they say that economic loss will be how much? Nah. So what is economic loss in Delhi in around 2002? It is how much if 7 occurs?
$16 billion.
$16 billion, but that was in 2002. Now how much it will be? 2020. You just see the real estate prices, you know. See, like in 2002, say, if you see in Chennai, outside our IIT, Velachery, you followed, apartments was costing around 20 lakhs. You followed. Now they are all costing, you see, 2 crores. So how much, you know, in just 20 years, you say, the things have, you followed, right? So from 20 lakhs to 2 crores. So you can just, so 16, this has to be multiplied by, you followed, right? 10 or maybe, you know, 50 times or something like that. Okay, so this much will be there. So 16 paisa, you know, so just to calculate, you know, maybe in terms of hundreds or, you know, that many dollars itself. Now, similarly, Chennai. So if there is a 6.5 in Chennai, the economic loss is, you know, $4.5 billion. but that was in 2002. So now, right now, you followed, right? All these numbers are to be multiplied by 50 or, you know, 50 times or maybe 20 times, 30 times, you know. So these numbers will be very, very high actually, okay? So who is more worried about economic losses? None. Now, who is more worried about economic losses? So there are two types of losses are there. So human losses, insurance companies are worried. Economic losses, who are worried?
Government.
Government, but government also, they are not worried. Only Nirmala Sitharaman is worried, the finance minister. You followed, right? So if you tell, if you show these numbers to her, and she may get even you followed, right? Earthquakes, say, they may get, you know, finance minister will be in problems. So economic loss is a finance minister and human loss is insurance sector. But nowadays, economic loss, you know, we are also struggling. See, suppose, you know, if earthquake occurs in Delhi, say, see, some, previously, in 10-15 years back, you know, whenever earthquakes have been, people in South India, okay, in Chennai and other places, because here earthquakes, the frequency is very, very less in Chennai. If you see this graph, right? So here in South India, say, very less earthquakes occur in South India. So in South India, you know, people used to feel that, we are not earthquakes, you know, there is no need to worry about earthquakes. And earthquakes will occur only in Himalayas. And these places only are in great danger, you know, we are safe, you followed, right? So this is a mentality, actually, generally in this one. But now, if earthquake occurs in Delhi, what happens to you in Chennai? Suppose if earthquake occurs in Himalayas, say, whether we will be, whether it will hit us?
So indirectly, we will be also affected, sir.
How? What is that indirectly means? How? And what
so
way
in
you
terms
are
of resources which are imported and exported from Delhi?
No, not imported or exported. You followed, right? Suppose if earthquake occurs in Delhi, if there is an earthquake in Himalayas, a 9 magnitude or something, what happens? Your budget, you know, the whole money will go towards this itself. So finally, what happens if you are in Chennai, earthquakes will not hit you. Here, earthquake will hit your buildings and, you know, the human losses will be there and economic losses also. But what happens is people in Chennai say, okay, whatever economy loss is happening in Delhi, so that will be, you know, your income tax, you followed it, our taxpayers' money, whatever you are paying taxes, say. So all of them, you know, will go to, you followed it, to repair this city itself. So earthquakes doesn't hit people. So in South India, say, earthquakes, they hit, your pockets actually, okay? So like if the whole budget goes away, then government will not have any money to pay your even your stipend also. Your stipend may be cut, our salaries will be cut, you followed, right? So earthquakes doesn't hit you, but earthquakes will hit your pockets also. So this is also a very, very important thing, okay? So people say that, you know, in South India, you know, we are not interested in earthquakes. That is sure, it will not hit you, but it is going to hit your pocket, it is going to cost you actually, okay? That is the most important thing you should be see. So earthquake means not only human loss, you will have economy loss also. So now, so these are the two things when earthquake occurs. So finally, you know, so now what is earthquake engineering? Now let us define. So already we have seen earthquake means, you can have a human loss and you can have economy loss. So two things will be there. Okay. So now this is the main applicable. So earthquake engineering, that is defined like this actually. So it is basically the application of, civil engineering. Okay. So to reduce life and economic losses, both you have to do, not just life safety. So if you protect all the people, say, and if the economy collapses also, then also gone, okay, because no jobs, no money, that is also a big issue. So our civil engineering, so the main objective of earthquake engineering, you see, is to reduce life as well as this economic losses. So this is how the earthquake engineering is defined as. And the main objectives of earthquake engineering, you can be stated as reduction or mitigation of the seismic risk. So this is a technical, the term. So the objective is to reduce this seismic risk actually. Okay, so this risk is a very famous word actually, okay? So the definition of earthquake engineering is this, the application of civil engineering to reduce, and the main objective of earthquake engineering is to reduce, the seismic risk. Okay, so this is the objective of earthquake engineering. Okay. So now let us see what is a seismic risk. Okay. So now, you know, seismic risk generally, we will cover this in detail after some time. Is basically it is something like, you know, we talk in terms of probability because, you know, of uncertainty, you know, in this earthquake. So it is defined like the probability of losses, okay? So occurring due to earthquakes within the lifetime of a structure. So this is what we call as, you know, the seismic risk. So probability of loss, you know, this is what we call as a seismic risk. Okay. So now, of course, human lives, social, economic, and all those things are there. So now the seismic risk side is basically defined as product of two things actually. Okay, seismic hazard. Then you have this vulnerability also multiplied by vulnerability. So now, of course, nowadays, you know, people have added some more terms like, you know, if you see the recent textbooks, say exposure time also they write. Okay. Then now recently they have added one more thing also, resilience, they say. Okay. So nowadays, you know, this resilience is a very, very popular word nowadays. Okay. Resilience based design and other things also have come up. Now, what is meant by seismic hazard? It is just defined like this. So probability of a potential damaging earthquake, say, occurring at your city, planned construction with its design like. So this is what we call as, you know, the seismic hazard. That is the probability of earthquake occurring at your city. Then vulnerability is, suppose if earthquake occurs, say, still, if you have designed your structures properly, the damages may not be there or may be there actually, okay? So the probability of a damage, so if the earthquake occurs, what is the probability that your building will be damaged actually, okay? So this is what we call as, you see, the vulnerability. And exposure time is, you know, something like, you know, if earthquake has not occurred for last 50 years, say, then what is that if earthquakes have not been occurring for last 100 years, say, in Delhi or some place, say, what does it tells you? Your exposure time is increasing because we all know that Himalaya is a very active region. Earthquake will occur, sure, actually. But if it is, suppose if a large earthquake has occurred just right now in Nepal, and now what is the probability of earthquakes, same earthquake occurring in near future? See, in Himalaya, if you see, right? So where is, you know, the more probable? So now if you see this map, so now in Himalaya, so this portion actually, so this portion now Nepal, there has been an earthquake. So once a large magnitude earthquake occurs, what happens after some time? So like here 8.6 magnitude occurred in 1950. Now how many, if a large magnitude occurs in 1950, say, what happens in 1951, 1952, 1953, earthquakes will occur or not?
Aftershocks will occur.
Aftershocks will be there, but they will be very, very small actually. Now suppose, yeah, what is the probability that 8.6 will occur in 1951 also?
It's very less.
It's very less. Now after 10 years, the probability, what happens as the duration increases, say 1950, so from 1970 to 1960, say, the probability of occurring 8.6 magnitude will be very, very low because already it has occurred, the large magnitude. Suppose if the exposure time, you know, 50 years, 100 years, 500 years, say, then what happens? Say 1950, you add another 500 years, what is the probability of another 8.6 magnitude occurring at a place in 500 years? What happens? Probability will increase or decrease?
It will increase.
Increase. So what does it mean? So that is what we call as, you know, exposure time actually. Okay. So now suppose if a large magnitude has occurred right now, say, so this earthquake occurring for another 50 years will be very, very small. But you know, when the time is increasing, you know, then you see this risk also increases. That is what we call as, you know, exposure time actually. So these are, you know, this word that is exposure time, this much. Okay. So now in Himalaya, in Delhi, say, this exposure time is, you know, very, very high. Because in Delhi, I think, you know, in the last 500 years, so you can see this region. You can see this region, you can see. Now, you can, all of you can see this region. This portion, what is happening in this portion?
So, only one major earthquake has occurred.
So, only one red dot is there, but black dot means greater than 8 magnitude. Till now, actually, you have not seen in this region. So what does it tells you?
There is a probability that it might occur in near future.
No, but what is the probability? Suppose if I compare this region, say, where it will be more exposure time, both are Himalayas only. So where exposure time is more, so here already in 1905, we had one earthquake actually, but here there was no activity, say. So what does, and expand, you know, in the last 100 years, you know, no earthquake has occurred here. So that means the exposure time in this region is much, much higher than exposure time here itself. So that is how, you know, this has to be interpreted. Okay, so as exposure time increases, say, then also your risk increases actually. Okay, and now the last word is resilience. What do you mean by resilience? Now, what's the meaning of resilience?
Capacity to withstand.
Yes, capacity to withstand. Okay, so there are some people, right, or some communities, say, if we get any, you know, this type of any, you know, disaster happens, how fast you can recover. Okay, so how fast you can recover is what we call as resilience. Okay, so this is what we call as resilience actually. So now, who, like, in not only resilience is not only for a community, it may be for a person, or, you know, it depends on the person's, communities and other things also. Who is the best person for resilience? Whose resilience is high for people among all people, say, who is having 100% resilience? So resilience means if any disaster happens, say, that person will not, you know, he will be still strong actually. You followed, right? So nothing will happen to that fellow. So who is the best example for 100% resilience?
So Indians, in terms of earthquake, Japan, I think, sir.
No. We are not talking about earthquake. Resilience is how fast you can recover. Who is the best example of a person? Can you name any person who is 100% resilience? What type of person he should be? Whatever disaster happens to him, say, he is a perfect actually. He will not do anything and he will be still be fine. Nothing will affect that fellow. Now, who has 100% resilience? Name any person. Have you seen any person like that?
Maybe in movies.
No. In movies, you can see anybody followed, right? But in real world, so who is a fellow? You have seen many people, right? In your popular people only, who are 100% resilient. Whatever disaster happens to him, they will be very, very strong, very strong personalities. Name one fellow. Now, who is the best example for 100%? He is a very popular figure. Everybody knows him. Can anybody guess?
Prime Minister.
Who?
Prime Minister.
Prime Minister.
Gandhi is resilient.
Gandhi. Gandhi, these people have nothing. You know? They are just freedom fighters. That fellow should be affected by a natural disaster, but nothing will happen to that fellow. Very strong. Gandhi, Prime Minister, no, they were not resilience persons actually. Who is the best scientist? His name is a very famous scientist also. Okay, I can give you one more clue also. He is a very famous man in physics. Guess physics scientist, you know?
Tesla.
Who? Tesla.
Nikola Tesla.
He is a disaster fellow, Tesla. Nothing happened. He was fine, right, that fellow? He passed away recently only. Physics, cosmology, he discusses, you know, evolution of stars.
Stephen Hawking.
Stephen Hawking. What is the speciality about Stephen Hawking? Yeah, what is the speciality of Stephen Hawking? What type of disaster he has seen? You know, right, all of you, Stephen Hawking.
Black holes?
No, that is a black hole. But I am talking about resilience person. What has happened to that fellow? His body is a paralysis. His leg doesn't work, hand doesn't work, voice doesn't come. Nothing works in his body. But what did he do? Whether he packed his research or whether he committed suicide or what did he do, that fellow?
Committed to research.
How much disaster happened to him, still he did research, right? He published books, he did everything, his thinking didn't stop. is excellent researcher. So that type of people we call as 100% resilient. Nowadays there are people, right? If somebody scolds them itself, they will commit suicide, they will give up actually in life. Okay, so that is there 0% resilience, we say. So resilience means, you know, if there is any natural disaster happens also, they will recover. Nothing will happen to that fellow. He will still stay strong. He will do his work. He will do excellent work also. That is what we call as resilience actually. Okay, so the best example for 100% resilient person, say, is nothing but, you know, the Stephen Hawking, very, very famous, you know, right? Gandhi or even our prime minister or whatever, you just compare this Hawking, you know, Hawking's body doesn't work, but still, you know, so that generally, that's how, you know, resilience, you know, Stephen Hawking name automatically comes, this word resilience, say, because, you know, he's a very, very strong fellow. So anyway, that is for a person, but, you know, for communities also. So resilience is very, very important. Like this COVID situation you have seen, right? So which community was very strong in the entire world? Which country you followed, right? How they handled this COVID situation, say. That itself tells you, you followed, right? The resilience of society or something. Of course, our India, they have done a wonderful thing itself. So you can now tell us that in COVID situation, you know, Indian community performed better, or Japanese community, or Chinese community, or American actually, okay? So that, you know, resilience. So this resilience means how fast you can recover. So these are the four things are there. So seismic hazard, then, you know, vulnerability, exposure time, and then this resilience, okay? So now this seismic hazard, say, so this we cannot control actually, okay? So this is done by nature, because earthquake occurrence is not in our hand, so this is nothing we can do. But what is the thing among all these things which you can control? Human beings, which our engineers, we can control, which are among these four aspects, which thing we can control?
Vulnerability
we can control. Exposure time you can't do. Seismic hazard you can't do. Resilience also we can build. We can build communities, you know, which are very, very strong also. That is also one aspect. But of course, as engineers say, so resilience, you know, is not our, you know, we as an engineer, you know, we may not be able to do, but this vulnerability thing, say, so this is where, you know, our earthquake engineering comes actually. So earthquake engineering, say, so this is determined by man or engineer, we say, so this can be reduced. So if we can reduce this vulnerability, say, to zero, say, then what happens to seismic risk?
Zero.
Risk is zero. Although seismic hazard is very large, even though 9 magnitude occurs also, but your vulnerability is so strong, say, or vulnerability is zero, so almost very, very less, seismic risk will be zero itself. But of course, we can't make vulnerability zero. But so if you want to reduce the seismic risk, the only way is you followed it. This vulnerability is the most, you followed it, the important thing. Okay. So the job of earthquake engineer is to reduce this vulnerability. So anyway, that's what I told. These are the economic losses or seismic risk actually. So the seismic risk is generally told in terms of economic losses. Okay, that's $16 billion. So this is a risk for Delhi city. Okay, this is a risk for Bombay city. So to calculate this seismic risk, say, they do all these calculations. Seismic hazard, then they also will calculate how vulnerable the buildings are there in Delhi city. Then the exposure time they calculate, you know, resilience they calculate. Of course, resilience is a recent work which people are adding in our this itself. So now for Stephen Hawking, so what is the seismic risk for Stephen Hawking? Sir, not seismic, risk for Stephen Hawking. One minus resilience if you put, okay, I'm sorry. One minus resilience if you write, say, for Stephen Hawking, what is resilience? He is a perfect fellow, no? That fellow, all the body paralysis, still he is doing excellent research. So Stephen Hawking resilience is 100%, or it is 1. So what will be the risk for Hawking?
Zero.
Zero, obvious, right? That fellow is so great. You followed, right? So, you know, so this is how, you know, you can calculate all these numbers. But anyway, we have not been discussing resilience in this course, but we will be most interested in this vulnerability itself. So the job of earthquake engineer, so these are how the risks are calculated. A final risk is in terms of money only, okay? Economic loss, $10 billion or something. So vulnerability is very, very strong, say, in our country, like, you know, where vulnerability is low, buildings are very, very strong, then this economic loss can be reduced to zero itself, okay? That is how it comes. So that's what we say. So how to reduce seismic risk? So we can't touch hazard, we can't touch the resilience, we can't touch resilience, of course, there are other ways also. We cannot touch exposure time. The only way to reduce is this vulnerability. That means, you have to design, you follow, right, the buildings in a nice fashion. But if you want to design a building, say, the most important thing is this design ground motion. So you should know how to estimate these design values in a proper fashion itself. And this itself is a challenge. That is, estimation itself is very, very tricky for earthquakes actually, okay? So I will show you. So this is for the Japan, okay? So, so for Japan's 2011 Japan earthquake. So if you see this Japan earthquake, say, the maximum PGA was how much? So how much was the max? So these are all these places. PGA was more than, I think, the 1G. So what was the highest PGA during Japan earthquake? No.
2.75.
No, 2.75 or almost 3G actually. Okay. Now in our IS codes, what is the highest zone value? That's a PGA value. In IS
1893.
2.5. 0.36G. Now you compare with Japan. What is the Japan PGA? 3 times gravity, 2.5 times or something. Almost it is, huge when variation is there. Suppose if this type of earthquake occurs in India, say, do you think all the buildings will be standing?
No.
So now you follow, right? So just think about these things, okay? Then another thing is this main thing earthquakes say. The most challenging thing is earthquakes, the upper limit is not known actually, okay? So like in 1930, the instruments started coming. So at 1930 in US, there was one earthquake, okay? So at that time, you see the highest recorded PGA was, something around 0.2G like that it was there in the olden days. So in those olden days, people thought that, earthquakes cannot produce more than 0.2G itself. That is how the intention was. Then in 1940, there was one earthquake. I think Imperial Valley earthquake or something was there. So suddenly the PGA was 0.36G or something was recorded. Okay, the highest PGA recorded during that time in the whole world. Then slowly you followed it. Earthquakes started occurring. So then people thought that earthquakes never can produce ground motions more than 1 times gravity. Then suddenly, in 1971, there was one San Fernando earthquake in USA. So there, the maximum PGA recorded was more than 1G actually on horizontal, these sites. So then people, earthquakes can produce 1G like this, it changed. Then, that was the high world record was 1G during 1970. Now slowly earthquakes started occurring. And finally, I think somewhere around 1985 or something, this highest thing occurred around 2.5G or something like that. Then the people told, so the maximum is 2.5G. So earthquakes will never produce more than 2.5G. That was understanding. Suddenly in 2009 or 2007, there was one earthquake in Japan that almost, I think, 7.5 magnitude or something like that. The maximum PGA recorded was, 3 times or 4 times gravity itself. Very, very high. So now, so this is a record. So till date, the highest PGA observed during an earthquake is almost close to 4 times gravity. Now, if you are, so generally when you're designing a building, say, we want the building to be safe in the future actually. So now, if you see in the next 50 years, say, how much PGA, what will be the maximum PGA, how much PGA we are going to observe, whether it will be more than 4G or less than 4G.
So more than 4G.
We don't know. That's what I'm saying. You have no idea. We don't know whether 4G will be exceeded, So earthquakes are notorious. They create world record. They break their own record, like that. They are going. So now in the next 50 years or maybe 2100 or something. So we don't know that. So we have not even seen the upper limit actually. So this upper limit is not known for, the earthquakes. This is a very, very, important thing in seismic also. This is what we said, right? So now our IS code, if you want to compare, say, where is our IS code? Now, what is the maximum value in our IS code? 0.36G. So where are we? We are in which year? See, around? 1940 or something. So now where is the now? So right now you see we are here. You followed it 4 times gravity or something like that. So now if I ask you the questions, are you safe when you use IS code? In the next 50 years, you say. So very, very difficult question, and you know, very, very difficult or very tough question it is. You know, are you safe? You may follow IS code, but still, we have no idea, because earthquakes are you know, notorious to create their own, you know, the world records. Okay, so this was for Christchurch earthquake. 6 point was there in New Zealand. So this earthquake, this is 1G, and the scale is 1G, 1G vertical acceleration. So this earthquake was also very, very special earthquake. So you can see at many places, epicenter was here. So HVAC stations, the PGA was more than, you know, 2 times, you see the gravity. And the earthquakes, you know, the many generally earthquake means people think horizontal only is important. But here the verticals was more than horizontal. See, like you can see this station also. The vertical was more than 2G or something, but horizontal was 1 times gravity also. You can see these numbers are, you know, extremely high actually. And if you want to compare with our IS codes, 0.36G, just to compare, you know, once again, if I ask the questions, are you safe? You know, it's very, very, you know, difficult to answer these type of questions itself. Okay. So anyway, so I think you followed it. I will stop here. We will continue, you know, in our next class. Okay. So if you have any doubts, you can ask. So if you have any doubts, you please ask me.